Hi, good afternoon, everybody. So what we're going to do in the next 45 minutes or so is talk about, you know, how credit and lending mechanisms are evolving in India, especially in the last 2 to 3 years. And we have an esteemed group of panelists with us to talk through that. We'll try and cover various aspects of the lending part, which is, you know, the credit itself, the digital distribution part of it, the process innovation part of it. And I know that there is quite a lot of work that's happening. And finally, we'll also try and touch on the regulation aspect on how that's kind of going to come in and impact the way the players kind of look at this space. So what I'll do is I'll try and just give you a little bit of context on what I think happens at an overall level and the context of the Indian market. So out of the total population of 1.2 billion people in India, our urban population is about 40%, give or take. If I look at, you know, the number of people who have any access to credit, that's about 200 to 220 million. So that's about 18 to 20% of the population, excluding the microfinance part of it. If we then dig a little deeper and look at people who have a credit score of greater than 750, which is very broadly a threshold that's applied by most of the banks for extending credits to consumers, that number would be about 40 million, which is about 4% or slightly lower of the population. You then superimpose that with the percentage of people who are taxpayers in India, and we all saw that stream of data when the year ended. That number is about 40 million again. Again, 4% of the population pays tax. So kind of from a bank's or a lender's perspective, easy to estimate salaries or incomes of those population. Then you look at another product, which is you know, very popular product and usually the first point of extension of, or was the first point of extension of credit, which is credit cards. They're about 25 million credit cards, so about 2.5%. That gives you a context of the opportunity and the space available in India. Compare that with a market like US, where the credit card penetration will be 2x of the population. So there'll be more than 350 million cards in the market. Again, I look at another aspect, which is the accept rates of when people apply for a loan. In a market, developed market like US and UK, that number will be between 30 and 35%. In India, in a population that applies offline and online, that accept rate is estimated to be about 9% as per, you know, the Bureau estimates. If you look at online platforms, that number is likely to be slightly higher. So with that context, what I do is I'll extend the invitation to all the panelists to start sharing their context on how they see lending, how they see the trends, and which areas are they trying to impact from a credit and lending expansion perspective. I'd like to start with Manish. Manish, if you can start with sharing your context.
Sure. Thanks a lot for this. So as we are seeing it in the country, very rightly you pointed out, there is this large gap between the demand and, or rather potential demand and the supply of credit. And if you want to break the whole lending cycle into various stages of identifying this customer, the channel to reach out to this customer, then let's say the credit assessment of this customer and documentation, let's say the second last step, and finally the money movement, both for disbursement and collection. We are seeing various models come about on all these five stages of assessment of or delivery of credit to this customer base. And directionally, I think everybody is headed in the digital direction. And of course, some enablers in the ecosystem, including Aadhaar ecosystem, helping a lot in completing the KYC of the customer or identifying the customer. CIBIL records, which to some extent give information about the intention of the customer to pay back. And the last, in a way, battle, you can say, or the still a hurdle to be crossed, is the assessment of the risk of this customer. Now, fundamentally, as I would understand, as you are going deeper down this segment, and whether we are saying the 200 million plus segment or any of a similar kind of a number, the traditional model of lending against a security starts breaking down. And the need to assess the cash flows of the customer and the ability of the customer to service a certain sum of money, that goes up. That's where the strength of any credit model lies. And that's what, over a period of time, is going to differentiate between one supplier and another supplier of credit. Though currently, if you see, as I said, all these five stages of delivery of credit, everybody is working in making sure that this is a seamless process and a seamless experience for the customer. So have we, as Arth Impact, we have focused on the small merchants and digitized this whole process of reaching out to the merchants and giving them credit in a completely digital, paperless way. We have access to some 1 million small merchants now to whom we are in the process of giving the credit. But over a period of time, as I said, the risk assessment of the ability of this merchant to service or the other similar customers to service a similar sum of money would be the key differentiator between one entity and another. And like everybody else, we are also still working on it.
Adhil, both of us are in the same space. We are trying to work with the players in the ecosystem to, adopt or adapt the digital process much more. I know we are working towards a paperless. Would you like to talk about the process innovations and what's happening and the impact that you think, players like us are causing?
Yeah, at Bank Bazaar, we see this as a very, very exciting time. I think there are three trends which stand out very clearly. So trend number one is we have a population which the minute it needs anything opens up its mobile phone and starts the process of accessing what they want. So from a consumer side, right, we've seen a phenomenal rise, especially post demonetization, where at Bank Bazaar we are seeing as many as 16 million visitors on a monthly basis come to the site to get and access the right financial product, be it banking, insurance, mutual funds, savings. So the first trend that we see standing out, right, our country is going through a phase wherein everyone, be they young, middle-aged or old, are starting to use their mobile phone to do things that they might not have done 10 years ago. And I think we have Amazon to thank for that. That's trend number one. Trend number two, right, the people who come online on their mobile phone asking for a mutual fund, asking for a fixed deposit, asking for a credit card, these people are not willing to go through the age-old processes. So they're not saying that, okay, you take my mobile number online and then send someone to my house. I'll give 6 months banking data in paper. I'll give 3 years IT data in paper. They're actually saying, if we can do this entire process electronically because of what is happening with the government, because of what is happening with eKYC, because of what's happening with eAdhaar, I want to be able to access this process without paper. So I think there's a very clear demand, right, saying it doesn't matter if I'm in the biggest metro or the smallest village. I want to be able to access financial products on my mobile phone. If I can access everything else on my mobile phone, why not access financial products without paper? That's the second trend, which is paperless. The third trend, right, is very close cooperation between the financial institutions and fintechs in this field. So Mr. Vaidyanathan is in the audience. He was speaking earlier. Working very closely to say that, hey, there's tremendous amount of expertise built up in the banking industry, in the mutual fund industry, in the insurance industry. While the fintechs have built tremendous amount of access and technology for paperless, how can we collaborate to make this a win-win situation for everyone? So broadly, these are the three trends that we see sweeping across the market at Bank Bazaar.
Thanks, Adhil. Rahul, question for you. If you can just take a minute to explain what you do and how you are trying to expand credit, I would think, in an area which was, which was not, where the banks were not very comfortable to lend to for a long period.
Hello. Yeah, to start off, I'll just like to brief the current or basically the traditional processes which continue to happen at banks and financial institutions. Like traditionally, as we all know, lending in India has been restricted to brick and mortar stores, which are basically run by banks and financial institutions or by local money lenders, both catering to different set of borrowers. Further, these banks and financial institutions have their age-old practices of taking, say, IT documents, financial statements to evaluate. And further, they do not lend to people who are not creditworthy, who, say, won't have a good CIBIL score or who don't have sufficient collateral or backing for a slew of banking products. And also, most of the banks would rely on the decentralized evaluation of credit. Basically, they'll be relying on credit officers' judgment to lend to a particular segment or not. So that has been one of the major constraints, and another constraint has been the reach, the operational reach of the banks. They, even today, if you look in India, the most well-reached bank won't have more than, say, 200 or 250 branches. But what we at Lendingkart group are doing is phenomenally different. Like currently, we have catered to more than 550 cities across India in more than 28 states. So what we do is basically we have taken the process entirely online. The entire set of document collection, the entire loan evaluation, and the entire disbursements happens all in all through electronic means. We have gone entirely paperless. And in fact, post demonetization, there has been a phenomenal pickup in the number of online digital applications which we are receiving at Lendingkart. Further adding to that, what traditional banks were doing were basically relying on credit assessment officers to evaluate. But at Lendingkart and other fintech startups which have come up recently, most of them have been focusing on big data analytics using algorithms to evaluate the credit worthiness of the borrowers.
Sure. Thanks. I have a follow-up question, but I'll come back to you. We'll move to Rajat. Rajat had started one of the, you know, one of the very innovative kind of ways of lending, which is P2P lending. But over the last couple of years, would love to hear your thoughts on how the regulation is playing out. How do you see P2P evolving as, you know, in terms of expansion of credit and innovation in credit?
Yeah. So, hi, I'm Rajat Gandhi. The way we see it, there's a lot of work which has always been happening for last, I think, for 2,000 years on the, it's a quite an old industry, banking industry. There's a lot of work which is happening on the demand side, but very little work happening on the supply side, which is the lending side. It's basically I borrow money or I have some money, I lend out to people. And you have financial institutions which do that. And there's a lot of work, the way we see it, is happening on how to appraise a borrower based, whether it's with paper, without paper. These are operational, in my mind, these are operational issues. Yes, of course, they reduce the friction. But after reducing the friction, what does it happen? Do I get a lower rate of interest? No. So the last big innovation banks did was ATM. My lending, the deposit rates are the same. My borrowing rates are the same. So all this cost saving is somewhere going down and back into the, these corporations, which large banks or money lender or the lending institutions. We as a company or as a business model, we are challenging the supply side. We're saying, why am I paying a premium for these, the supply side? Why am I paying for a brand called HDFC with all due respect to them or ICICI? Because at the end of the day, the money is the same. So what we've done is we are saying that there are 100 crore people out here and they all have their savings and it's lying at 2% or 4%. Can we unlock that and create an exchange and new asset class where you can benefit the way a large institution does that? And that's primarily because this huge amount of work which has happened, this business was wouldn't be possible 5 years back, let me assure you. Because it needs a whole lot of digital streams of data, and which has become a commodity right now. So say Adil's company or Lendingkart, they're all working on the same data. So we are saying, can we give this data to you as an individual and you can make the same profits what these guys are making? And that's the business model which we are coming. Now, of course, it challenges a whole lot of stuff on regulation, everything, mindsets. And mind you, this business is not a new business. It's just we are taking the informal economy onto a formal sector and digitizing it and creating velocity on that. So actually speaking, 90% of India lives out of P2P lending. In the informal sector, in the villages and everywhere. They are not going to the banks. The banks and the financial institutions don't reach out to not more than 10% of the population. And as per them, 90% of India is not credit worthy, which in my mind is illogical. So we are saying that the people who believe that the other people are credit worthy, let them transact between themselves. And this is what we are unlocking. Look, the regulations always follow innovation. You cannot expect the regulator to be the innovator. And because they are there to put the guidelines, they are put to after you set up the business. The right way of doing that is to engage with the regulator. That's what we've done. Tell them what you are doing, rather than saying that doing under the carpet or saying, okay, we'll scale it out and then we'll go and say we create a problem and then let them come in. We've taken a totally different approach on this. From before we started engaging with the regulator. And not only as whatever we are learning, we are sharing it with our regulators and saying that this is what we've learned. This is the journey we are going through. Why don't you come in and help us make this industry into a proper industry? So that's the approach on the regulation. And they have been very proactive on that. Sure. They've been really helpful.
Sure. One comment to make was that, you know, in fact, in India, from what I've seen across the globe, our regulator, RBI, is one of the most progressive regulators. You know, you can see that from the way they have tried to expand access to financial systems by releasing payment bank licenses and small finance bank licenses, rather than just going a traditional way of just giving more corporate houses newer licenses who would have targeted the same set of customers. Of course, it'll be very, very exciting to see how that pans out over the next 5 to 10 years. But so far, I think the strategy seems to be that if there's any player who's trying to expand the financial system access and in a responsible manner, RBI has looked at that very positively. Although with, of course, with caution. Just kind of opening up the discussion a little bit. You know, from what I see, there are three ways or three kind of levers you can move in credit. One is the expansion of the credit segment itself, you know, by kind of reaching out to hitherto untargeted or less targeted segments. You know, a lending card is targeting one of that, which is self-employed and SMEs. There are other segments like new to credit or near prime or subprime, which still sees a vacuum right now. Or there are very few players. Cap First is one of the players there. The other is expanding distribution, which is, you know, by the players developing innovation models on point of sale or bringing out digital process and digital kind of distributions to expand the reach. And the third is product and process innovation. So would like to ask anybody to kind of, if you can talk a little bit about how do you see the expansion of credit evolving and the, you know, the trends that are happening there?
Anybody? Me?
Yeah.
So I would say the first one, or the expansion of the segment, is the key way in which this whole growth is going to happen. As far as the process is concerned, I think after a while, that digital process will become a par process, or, you know, the norm process. Different people are at different stage of innovation there. Of course, some are leading, but slowly others will also catch on. But the expansion of segment is going to be the key thing. And if you want to, you know, follow the traditional way the market has been divided into the below poverty line customer and the above poverty line customer and the middle class and the upper end, this above poverty line customer that we say in the income bracket of 1 to 5 lakh per household per year is typically a micro entrepreneur. 60% of them are the typical micro entrepreneurs we see there, where a proprietor is running an establishment and various kind of form factors. This is where the key gap is. And this is where I think the most opportunity lies, in being able to assess the risk in a manner different than what a bank does. And loosely said, you know, what a bank does typically, hopefully, a non-bank or NBFC will not do. Otherwise, banks also, I'm sure, over a period of time will go deeper from what they are serving and start serving a lower segment than what they are currently at, or cover the geographies where they are not present through a mix of physical and digital means. So that's the key segment, and that's where we think the opportunity lies.
So from my perspective, what we feel is that the beauty of the mobile tech that's being built in India today is that the same tech will solve many problems. And you detailed problems, right? You said top of the pyramid, what are you afraid of, right? You're putting money somewhere. Are you getting the right advice? Is it convenient? Bottom of the pyramid, what's the problem? You want to open up an FD for 500 rupees. You want a mutual fund for 2,000 rupees. It's too expensive to send someone to your house. Now, what we're doing with mobile paperless tech is building a technology which I think is applicable to both of these problems. Now, once you're able to say that the mobile phone in your hand will help you access any financial product without paper, automatically, right, whether you're in a metropolitan area or you're in a village, you now have access enabled to you. So we think the beauty of tech is that this is maybe today being used by the early adopters. Maybe today it's people like us who are consuming it. But eventually, the early adopters will give way to the mainstream. And when people can access a mutual fund for 2,000 rupees, think about it, right? There's a 1% trail commission on a mutual fund. So 2,000 rupees, there's a trail commission of 20 rupees. Now, who's going to come and advise you for 20 rupees? But on a mobile phone, if it was provided using tech, and by the way, today we do that in India. You can actually buy a 2,000 rupee mutual fund without paper on your mobile phone today in India. I think we have the unique opportunity today, right, of leapfrogging many generations of older ways of doing stuff to truly build something spectacular in financial services in India.
Well, the reality is that data is going to be the king, and we're seeing right from everybody talking that they're data analytics. So the key challenge is what will you do with the data? There's a huge amount of data coming in, whether it's your financial data, whether it's your clickstream data. The real challenge is whether it's the mobile data, your contact list, and everything. People are creating models on everything, the kind of friends you have and the kind of LinkedIn profile you have. But we are testing with psychometric testing. We've done a pilot with EFL. Now, the point is, how do you build these models and which are scalable? I think that's the big challenge which all the lending companies or lending exchanges like ours will be living through in the next decade. And the whole practice of which data means something in the credit cycle and which data has to be excluded. Now, this is the big challenge which is coming in. We've gone through the whole cycle with demonetization, huge amounts of data now coming. People are going digitally much more savvy. Thanks to Jio, a whole lot of population is now consuming more and more data, at least at the base level. So that's the big challenge is out there, what data to use. It's huge amount of data.
Sure. So mobile tech, paperless tech is something Adhil talked about. Data is what you talked about. Very, very relevant points. Leads me to the next question to you, Rahul, specifically. There is talk about technology currently being used by early adopters and technology being the innovation prong for you. But how do you see, let's say, 1 year, 2 years down the line when technology becomes more of hygiene? How do you then aim to differentiate versus the banks or NBFCs who will have the similar kind of technology and reach that you have today in the same segment?
Yeah, currently, like most of the traditional banks or the NBFCs, the per se adoption of technology hasn't been to the core. But as we see going, say, two, three years down the line, the technology would actually become a very hygiene, and people who do not adopt to that would basically eventually phase out. Just to give you some examples, like currently in India, we have 1 billion people having access to mobiles. more than 220 million people having smartphones and almost 300 people having internet access. And the whole penetration, the unprecedented growth in the fintech industry has been possible because of the incremental use of mobiles and the data which is available. Further, there has been regulatory push also. If we look at a couple of examples like relaxation of, say, KYC norms for small ticket transactions, exemption from, say, two-factor authentication for wallet transactions, and the Aadhaar initiatives, UPI, NPCI initiatives, that has been pushing technology, and most of the new age fintech startups have been building their products, technologies, and innovations on these. So it would be better for the traditional banks to adopt to it as soon as possible. And even we have seen a lot of private banks adopting to that, be it Axis Bank, be it HDFC or ICICI. To quote some examples, even the PSU banks like Bank of Baroda and Union Bank, they have also been quite forthcoming in terms of using technology, and we have seen quite large strategic partnerships with them.
Sure. Another leading question about, you know, the alternate data has been the buzzword in the last few months or probably a year or so. You know, I was in US about a month back, and I worked in UK earlier. Just a quick background to share with the audience, that when the last recession happened in US, two players who survived very beautifully in the whole recession from a lending perspective were Capital One and Amex. And both use data very, very extensively. And one of the senior leaders at Amex had put it very, very nicely. He said that people tend to overestimate both scenarios. When the credit cycle is good, they tend to overestimate and think that the credit will always be good. It's never the case. And when the recession comes, everybody just really pulls the plug and they think that recession is going to last forever. It's also never the case. So you need to be very, very smart about credit aspect of it. You need to be very smart about how you use data. Leading to the question on, you know, how do you see, you know, I see a lot of fintechs emerging in the last couple of years who I think haven't seen the last recession that happened in India, 2008 to 11. Number one. Number two, you know, there's a lot of talk about alternate data, especially, you know, from your perspective or your perspective as you underwrite some of the risk. Do you see any value yet in alternate data?
So we are experimenting with it. I'll be upfront on it. Frankly speaking, there's a huge amount of, with the traditional data, what we are trying to do is that itself is a huge piece. Because we are unlocking, with the traditional data, we are unlocking on the supply side and making people lend money, individual people lend money. Talking about alternative data streams, we experiment, as I said, we experiment with psychometric, with EFL, which is the US-based company, which is into psychometric. We've done a pilot with them. We are looking at small streams of data on social. But if you are asking me, is this the only way to take a credit decision? No, I don't think anywhere in the world people have really taken that call. But will it become one of the key components in the years to come? Yes. You cannot leave this data stream. But as of date, you cannot rely on it only. So that's our understanding of the whole thing.
Sure. Manish?
I would say slightly differently, or rather answer it slightly differently, not differing from your point of view. That I completely agree. So if we are really talking of this 800 million people who we said have not borrowed before, so my understanding is that there is nothing like alternate data. We are basically, everybody is trying to, since it's the credit judgment, we are trying to assess the ability and the intention of the person to pay this money back. And this is the only data we have for the customer. There is no, rather than calling it alternate data, I would say we are first time building a profile of the customer to say that what is this person's ability and what is this person's intention to pay, which for the 200 million people who have done a transaction in the past, borrowed and paid back, there is something available. And to refine upon it, we can discuss the alternate data options and all. But for this new segment, this is the only data which, or the only data point which are going to be available.
But I have seen one more thing, that you can use alternative data, maybe not for credit decisioning, but for collections.
Okay, sure.
Okay,
sure.
And to give early warnings or something like that.
That's
and
a good point.
Or do skip tracing and all that.
Sure.
So that out there, it's benefiting a lot more than in the pure credit decisioning.
That's a good point, yeah.
Yeah, just to add to your point, we at Lendingkart are using alternate data for both the cases, even for underwriting as well as for collections. Like we have been parsing the borrower's SMS data. We have been collecting, say, utility bills or the alternate data in the form of their, apart from the credit bureau scores, their transaction data from the banking. So we have been analyzing that over the past 15 months, and the early indicators have been quite good. Even on the collection side, the SMS data, what we are collecting, and because of the app which is getting installed on their mobile phones. So where he is traveling, what all transactions is he doing, if he is a defaulter, then we do get a good sense of the customer, the borrower's profile. And in fact, in few of the cases, it has helped a lot because we have been actually able to trace the customer and we have been able to collect.
Quick question on, have you seen that cycle kind of getting completed on the set of consumers who you took alternate data for, and have they kind of completed a credit or a payback cycle for you to get more confident on that?
Yeah, like as I said, the early signals have been positive. We at Lendingkart, our average portfolio size have been 6 to 7 months.
Sure.
And we have been underwriting since last 18 months.
Sure.
So close to two and a half cycles have been completed, and the results are quite good.
Very interesting, very interesting. Another question that kind of is naturally follows from the alternate data and the data you talked about, Rahul, that there is so much data that you can collect from the consumer. You know, Rahul was mentioning towards, you know, if you, as a consumer, you download the app and provide consent, normally we know that consumers may not know all the consents that they're providing. You know, your SMSs can be read, of course, your location can be read, and all of that data is good from an underwriting perspective if the customer is fully aware, first of all, and that data is only used for that. But as we've seen in some of the other economies and markets, that as this becomes more prevalent, privacy issues tend to become, you know, come to the fore, and there's a lot of kind of talk about that. How do you see that happening, and what's your view? Anybody can take that question.
Well, more than the privacy issue, I think more worried that Facebook and Google themselves will become credit decisioning engines. So
sure.
That's the bigger challenge actually than saying that privacy of data and all that. Of course, that will be there. But the way we see it, that Facebook controls a huge amount of data, Google controls a huge amount of data. And so from that perspective, they could actually roll out a product for lending institutions of while taking the credit decision. And do we want to get into their walled gardens? That's a bigger challenge for the industry rather than just the privacy part of it.
You want to mention that? Okay. So the next and slightly different question, taking a step back from data and credit, was specifically to you, Adhil, in terms of the fact you work with all the banks and NBFCs, and you know there's a lot of innovation that's happening in the form of India Stack, eKYC, eSign, eIncome, being possible technologically and process-wise. How do you see the adoption of that? What do you think are the areas where the industry has done well, and what do you think are the areas where the industry needs to do better?
Thanks, Naveen. So to your earlier question on information security and privacy, one of the things, you know, including many of the companies on this panel are doing, is we're coming together under industry forums like the IMAI, for example, to define standards for both information security and privacy. So that's, you know, something we're actively engaged in, and there's a lot more we should do there. As far as the adoption of the India Stack goes, I think in all financial institutions, and in Bank Bazaar, we have 75 financial institution partners. So we don't build our own product, but we collaborate with these financial institutions to deliver their product paperless. We find that in every institution, there is a clear understanding at the CXO level that paperless is the future. I think what we're dealing with, right, is today, it's an exponentially growing market, which is paperless. Everyone is coming online. But the bulk of the sourcing at the end of the day is done offline. So I think the challenge everyone is straddling with is, here is a market which is growing very quickly, exponentially, but it's smaller today. How much resources should I invest in it? Now, at the end of the day, right, when you do something paperless, think of it this way. In the past, you had a physical contract which you signed. Today, the Evidence Act allows you to e-sign a contract using your Aadhaar authentication. Now, that's a way of working which changes 20 years of our past. For 20 years, I've always collected a contract, stored it in a place, moved it to a processing hub, so on and so forth. And now that entire process is done digitally in 1 second. Are we ready for it? Now, interestingly, right, what we're finding out is when I sign a piece of paper, there's really no way to authenticate that I am who I say I am. And that person who's actually picking up, or the agent who's picking up that paper, can be dealt with multiple modes. However, when I'm e-signing a document, I'm doing it either based on my biometrics or I'm doing it based on a one-time password. There is very, very low chance that I can sign for someone else. So the risk is actually lower in the new process. But I think what all the financial institutions are grappling with is smaller market, expanding at exponential pace. How much resources do I invest? And how do I change an age-old process, which we've been doing for so many years, so many decades, in fact, which has worked well for us? Let's be honest about it, right? The financial services industry in India is doing very well. It's very mature. Hats off to them. But the question is, how do I now change that? And I think that's the process that we're going through. And I think what the Amazons of the world have done, right, what the Netflix of the world have done, is they've made that change rapid, right? So if anyone is not thinking about, how do I open a savings account on the mobile phone without paper? If anyone is not thinking about, how do I deliver a mutual fund in 3 minutes? If anyone's not thinking about, how do I give out a general insurance policy in 2 minutes? They know that they're going to get disrupted. I think that's what we're dealing with.
Anybody else? What I'd like to do is just take a short break here, in the sense that, you know, we will kind of not ask questions and answers ourselves. If there are any questions in the audience at this point, I try and get my panel to address those. Or otherwise, if there are no questions, we'll continue with the discussions. Any questions at this stage? Yes, that gentleman there. Is there somebody to pass the mic, please? Yeah? You can try and ask. I'll repeat it for the group if I can hear you. I can't hear you. So, yeah, we'll have to wait for somebody to get the mic. Or should I? Yeah, somebody's coming.
Hello, gentlemen. This is Jayaraman. I want to know that we know that there is a subprime crisis in US in 2008 due to the overlending of credit and lending mechanism. I want to know, what are the financial institutions' role in channelizing this defaulters rate? And in India, how the regulators play a predominant role in controlling the credit and lending mechanism?
Sure. Anybody wants to take the question? It's linked to the subprime crisis in US, and how do we basically try and manage as an industry as well as the regulator? Yeah, please.
So I think we are deviating too much from what we are discussing here, but I'll try to give a very short answer, and we have far better experts here to answer this off the stage, I guess. But the only way, one, India as a system is too far away from what happened as part of the subprime crisis, both by way of the model that we lend, which has largely been a secured lending with enough equity or margins of the person or the business in the system, vis-a-vis what happened as part of subprime crisis, where overlending was done. And lastly, I would say, we just heard the numbers in terms of the reach that the former system has gone to versus what happens in a developed financial market. We are far underpenetrated today to compare ourselves with that. And even now, as all of us try to meet that unmet demand, there is enough which is safe credit available in the ecosystem to, rather than going and saying that we will start going suddenly to everybody and providing credit to everybody. There's a lot of ground to be covered. We are too far away from there. From regulatory side, the only, the big guidance that regulator tries to play is to say an institution should not concentrate its risk on a single product, on a single segment, on a single entity by way of percentage of its own lent out portfolio, etc., etc. So they just force the lending organizations to defray the risk by distributing it very broadly. It's too big a subject to just try to answer.
There's Mr. Vaidyanathan who's sitting, so I try and get you the best answer for this, and I try and get a statement from Mr. Vaidyanathan. Sir, if you can comment on the question.
Okay, there is a movie called The Big Short. The Big Short. Okay, if any of you haven't seen that movie, please see that movie. The answer to this question will be crystal clear to you. I'll give you two or three instances from that movie, and I liked the movie so much I saw it a second time. It goes as follows. There is this gentleman who's figured out that there's something seriously wrong in the US submarket, and people are giving loans right, left, and center. So he goes to do some primary research. In the primary research, he goes to a sex worker and he asks her, saying that, look, you know, you got a loan like this, interest rates are going to go up very soon. How do you think you're going to pay it back? She says, oh, really? I have a problem. So he says, yeah, you have a problem. So how do you want to deal with it? So as he walks away, she says, hey, by the way, do you think I have a problem in both my loans? So he says, oh, you got two loans? So he says, no, what about the, I have two more loans. So basically, she's working in a bar and she's got these three or four loans. Then he walks away from there and then he goes to a person who's been defaulting on his loan for a primary work. And he knocks at the door and the guy opens the door. And then he says, is there somebody by this name living here? He says, what? You're giving a loan to my dog? To my dog? So basically, it's an extreme version of describing, and these are real instances, this is not a made-up story. These are real instances of people were giving, taking loans in the name of dogs, three, four loans, you know, absolutely bizarre. Now, park the discussion back to this audience since you asked me to comment about this. I do not think in India you really find that situation at all. We are talking of a situation where we're saying only 10% of India has been addressed, whole of India is underpenetrated, you know, there is KYC, there is this, there is that. So this is a very, very, very far cry. You know, when I'm US, I usually have the habit of switching on late night movies, late night what's going on the television screen, and every other moment you'll see one ad which says, hey, you got a problem with credit, come to me, I'll give you a loan if you're defaulting elsewhere. I don't see a single loan like that. If anything, people are saying, look, you know, you've got to be good on credit elsewhere and a bureau record is important and so on. So I genuinely believe, not just as an industry representative, but I really mean it, but I think we are really very, very, very far from any of those US comparisons. I think honestly, we should not confuse ourselves and complicate our minds. We have an underpenetration problem. We should deal with it and fix it.
Thank you, sir, for sharing that perspective. There's one more question in the middle, yeah.
An issue that a lot of mobile app-based startups face in India is that a lot of customers have smartphones that are not very highly efficient. So an iOS smartphone or a Samsung Galaxy S8 can handle a much larger app and a heavy processing app. But the smartphones that are sold in India are not that big on processing power and efficiency. How do startups like yours and yours plan on facing that issue or plan on dealing with that hurdle in the future, in the near future at least?
Sure. Can I share a quick perspective from my side? So this is, Adil mentioned in his one of his points that, you know, India is leapfrogging into using mobile. We see that happening in our businesses. So for example, in our business, 55% of the people now are accessing our site through mobile. I know that in e-commerce sector, that number would be 75 or so. So people are already using that despite the challenges that you mentioned. And you know, the good news is that what's happening is that each year, not even year, each half a year, 6 months, the technology is evolving, technology is developing, you know, the processes are improving, the data capability is becoming better, the internet access is becoming better, the broadband is not getting more expensive, it's getting cheaper. So all of these will continue to move in the right direction, and hopefully, you know, 1 year down the line will be much better than today. We're already seeing that, you know, majority of our customers are visiting on mobile. So this is happening for real. Any other perspective, Adhil, would you like to add? Yeah. Okay.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So a question is basically more around, you know, we have the baseline regulations, right, whether it is banking industry or insurance industry. And I think a lot of entrepreneurs I see here, you know, have their own different pockets of businesses. I think somebody commented around data as well. If I'm not wrong, it was Rahul who has been using data for underwriting and for other reasons. You know, these data elements are in pockets. You know, as I see, you know, whether it is a digital marketplace, whether it is a, you know, there are different businesses who have got different pockets of data. But the integration of this data from different pockets, as you know, there are a lot of, in US if you see, there are a lot of data aggregators or research firms who, you know, collate the data and so that you can make the right use of it. How do you see that to be converging, right, across different businesses, so that, you know, there is a seamless decision making happening, whether it is fraud, whether it is any other use case which is related to a digital economy?
I'll try and answer that. Look, the way we see it, everybody's trying to do the same thing in their own pockets, as you said. So every lending company is coming and saying that they have a secret sauce. Okay, I see the data, find these data points, and I give you a score and this kind of thing. The way we see it, that eventually, as this dust settles, there will be specializations coming in from loan origination and your decisioning, your collections and recovery. So there will be aggregators which will be aggregating all this. There will be specialized players who will only concentrate on loan origination. There will be specialized players in, say, decisioning, and there will be people on collections and those kind of things. But this is my view of how it may pan out, because everybody saying I'll use the same set of same SMS and do something, it's not going to last too long. There'll be people who'll just give you a score and those kind of things, specialize on those kind of things, loan origination. So that's, maybe Adhil can speak more about that.
From our side, what we're saying is that you've got to take in full package to the financial institution. So at BankBazaar, what we believe is, if we only took a data scope but we didn't have customers, the bank would say, interesting, you know, you have a scope, but do you have the customers to work, to prove, and to take it forward? The answer would be no. So on our side, we think that data is there, but you also need the customers, you need the access, the tech, and then you take a full package to a financial institution. But like Rajit said, I think different companies take different approaches.
Just to add to the angle of the question which you asked about using data for credit underwriting, you know, my view is very simple on that. It's not going to be about how much data do you have, because there's already more data than you can handle, than everybody can handle. It's about how you use the data. I shared an example of Amex and Capfin in 2007 to 2012 in US market. Bureau was very, very mature in US in 2007. Everybody had same amount of data, all the lenders. Two people did exceptionally well, which is these two guys, because they knew how to use the data more intelligently than others. So the trick will be what data do you want to use, and how are you collecting that data? Because the overall amount of data will be anyways more than what you want.
At that level, you know, you said, of course, US people have already converged, they have aggregated the data.
Yeah. Yep.
You think we are still there?
So my personal view, and I take the views from others also, there are parts of data which are getting there. So the credit data is becoming, bureau data is becoming more and more stronger. It's much stronger. In 2007 in India, the bureau was non-relevant almost. Now it's much stronger. The data is getting more and more robust and accurate. It's mandated by RBI to, for all banks to submit data to bureau. The income and the identity data, of course, is not at the same level at all. You know, that's a big difference in terms of, you know, verifying the identity, verifying the income, which is very, very easy in US, not easy at all in India, which is why a segment like self-employed, which is majority of the population, struggles to get access to credit. And there are very, very specialized players who do that. The social and the mobile data, I think India will just be at par very, very soon, if not already, because the data is the same. The amount of innovation that's happening in social, mobile, etc., is at the same stage. Any other views? Okay, we have time. I've been given a warning, so we have time for one last, maybe two, but otherwise last question.
Yeah. Hi. I want to borrow on your guys' experiences about creditworthiness. I have a small, very teeny tiny NBFC, and we've so far done secured lending. And since secured is kind of crowded right now, we wanted to move to unsecured. Now, there is a question of capacity and intent. So capacity, everybody can measure of repayment. Intent of repayment is a question. Now, Mr. Gandhi briefly said, of course, 90% of India is not uncreditworthy, but of your experiences, how do we, like urban and rural, how do we understand whether Indians are usually, how do you understand Indians are usually creditworthy or not? Like, do you loosely understand my question?
So, okay, I understood your question is around intention to pay.
Yeah.
Right. Yeah. I think that's the difficult part. Do we have got the science right? No. Nobody can ever come to know, because intentions vary at different stages of your life. And the loan period is typically, which starts at 6 months, it happens over, say, 3 years or 5 years, especially unsecured loan. Now, to say that I will take a decision of your intention today and it will be the same, say, 6 months down the line and 12 months down the line and 24 months down the line, I think it's difficult. That's the real part of the problem out here. And the reason people think, don't lend out to people, most people, is because they don't have, so typically what happens is, how do you see that whether you have intention or not? Because I want to see your past data, whether you're paying your bills on time, whether you're paying the other loans on time. So I presume that you are a good disciplined person, you'll pay up. Are we getting new data streams on that? Are we getting some trickle stuff on that? To see that there's a whole push on services data getting into credit bureau, electricity bills and all that. But their billing cycles and their billing is bad out there. Half the time there's an issue with the billing itself out there, whether your mobile phone, whether it can go out there. So it's a big challenge out here. So that's the reason people are seeing other your spending patterns. Where are you going and spending money? So that's a good data which is coming in, which we are trying to look at. Are you spending more money at pubs, or you are getting and buying something which is creating assets? So it's a consumption versus those kind of things. So that's a good indicator about your things. How frequently do you charge your mobile bill? That's a very good indicator that it shows that are you a planned person or not a planned person. So if you are disciplined, that supposing you do 200 rupees recharge every month, vis-a-vis 20 rupees today and 5 days later 50 rupees, or you 1 month you spend 500 rupees on your phone, or next month you spend 200 rupees only. Okay, so if there's no pattern, it means you do not know what you're doing, you're just being impulsive. Now, is that the only criteria about intention? It just shows your discipline. Now, you can superimpose that data and see that whether it's coming out. At a scale, having gone through a credit cycle with this data, no, nobody's gone through it. So there's a caveat to it. So that's our understanding. But we are experimenting with new sets of data on understanding intention.
Thanks. Sorry, we don't have time for more questions. We would be around, I would be, and some of the other panelists would be. So we can take some of the questions offline. Just want to kind of summarize in the end, take a minute. You know, we talked about various aspects. And personally, I've been in financial services for the last 16 years now. I think this is one of the most exciting times for retail lending in India. And my personal view is that it's just started, actually. You know, everything that you look at, whether it's the core points which are going to help expand lending, which is access to internet, access to mobile, those are moving in the right direction. There's a lot of innovation that the regulator is allowing or considering in terms of process innovations. There are a lot of new ideas and a lot of new companies who are coming in to disrupt the traditional lending methodology process. You know, whether it's in the form of in the SME segment, P2B segment, or subprime or near prime segments. There are other innovations that's happening around POS lending. I think so. Very, very exciting times for retail lending. There is, of course, a word of caution for the entire industry, which is that, you know, we've seen what happened in 2007 in India also, besides US, when you get too greedy or too kind of optimistic about lending, lending hits you back in the form of losses. So that's something that we would have to be careful as an industry and behave responsibly there. But otherwise, very, very exciting times ahead. With that note, I'd like to thank all the panelists for sharing their views with the audience, and thank you, audience, for kind of taking the time to listen to us. Thank you. Thanks.
Let's have a bigger round of applause for this very informative session. I request Mr. Naveen Kukreja to kindly present mementos to our panelists. We are pleased to have with us Mr. Manish Khera. Mr. Adhil Shetty. Thank Mr. Rajat Gandhi for joining us. We'd like to thank Mr. Rahul Sankhlecha. Thank you, gentlemen. May I request Ms. Ritu Maria to kindly come up and present a memento to our session leader and moderator, Mr. Naveen Kukreja. Ladies and gentlemen, we will now break for lunch. We shall commence our next session at 2. We'll see you back.